Thanks.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to all of you on behalf of the Dryden Historical Society. We wish to extend a grateful welcome to Dr. and Mrs. Lyons for being here today. Dr. Laurence Lyons, as you know, is co-author of the book, George Owen Squier. We owe homage to the late General Squier and Sister Mary Parker for remembering the county of Lapeer and the property that was bequeathed to the same. Dr. Lyons worked for 4 years on defense and intelligence projects while associated with the U.S. government, General Electric, and the British Aerospace, BAE. He retired from a subsidiary of BAE as vice president and chief engineer in 2006. He holds an AB from Harvard University and an MS and PhD in electrical engineering from Syracuse University. His avocation is military history, with particular interest in how technology influenced the conduct of World Wars I and II. He is a member of the Society of Military History, the Western Front Association, and the American Historical Society. He is an adjunct professor of electrical engineering at the universities of West Florida and South Alabama, and a consult with BAE. He is also the president of Harvard Club of the Mid-Gulf Coast, enjoys being a radio amateur with call letters KI4UUG. It is with great pleasure and an honor I introduce you to and welcome Dr. Laurence Lyons.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, I'm going to talk to you today about a very remarkable man who's a native of Dryden, George Owen Squier. Now, how did I come upon General Squier? The story goes like this. I've been interested in technology and warfare for a long time, and I'm particularly interested in the First World War. During the First World War, radio, as we know it, was in its infancy. The vacuum tube had just been invented, and people were only then starting to use it. Of course, the vacuum tube was the device that transformed electronics. It was the foundation of electronics. And given that it was available during the First World War, it was surprising to me that it was not used. In particular, because the high casualties associated with the First World War were largely a result of poor communications. For example, at the Battle of the Somme, the British sent wave after wave of infantry against largely intact defenses and lost 20,000 men in the course of about an hour. They were unable to call back the successive waves of infantry because they had no communication. They had no way of knowing that the first wave was dead, second wave was dead, the third wave was dead. And given this issue with communications and how important it was, or the lack of it was, how come the British didn't use communication in the First World War, radio communication? And I found an Englishman who had come to the same conclusion independently, and he wrote a book about it. After he wrote the book, I was very surprised to learn that the Americans, who came into the First World War in 1917, had in fact equipped their soldiers with modern communication, modern radio communication, vacuum tube communication. And the reason for that happening was this guy, Major General George Owen Squier, who was a PhD electrical engineer as well as a general officer. He was also in charge of the U.S. Signal Corps during the First World War, a highly remarkable individual. And I thought, well, that's very interesting that the Americans would have done it and the British didn't. And that is a whole different line of inquiry. Mostly the British didn't do it because they had no concept of what communications would mean. The Americans only had General Squier, who did understand that. And so he made sure that the Americans went into battle with modern communication systems. So then I wanted to learn a little bit more about General Squier. It turned out that a fellow, actually electrical engineer, Paul Clark, had written his dissertation at Northwestern on George Squier, but he never published it. So I was hoping he was still around, because he's a little older than I am, and I was able to find him, and suggested, say, Paul, would you like to publish your dissertation? We'll add more material, since your dissertation was published in 1970, and he was tickled pink to do it. So he and I collaborated on a biography of General Squier, based on his dissertation, but including a lot of other material. And the more you learn about General Squier, you see just what a remarkable fellow he is. He was, he got all kinds of honors because he was ahead of the signal corps during the First World War. And this is just a short list of many, many more honors he got. He got, to take the ones at the bottom, the KCMG is a knight commander of the Order of St. Michael and St. George. He's Sir George Owen Squier, knighted by the Queen. He had similar high decorations from the Italians, from the French, and he got the Distinguished Service Medal from the U.S. He's a senior officer in the Army. He's certainly likely to get these kind of decorations at the end of the war. What is different about him is the first two. He has the Franklin Medal of the Franklin Institute of Philadelphia, which is awarded to very, very distinguished scientists every year. And he's also a member of the National Academy of Sciences. So this fellow is not only a military officer, a very successful military officer, he's also a scientist. And he's one of the very few scientists ever to receive that, or to gain that kind of rank in the military. So he's very, very one of a kind, if you will. He was born here. Here's a picture of his mother, Emily Squier. She died when he was born in 1865. She died when he was 7 years old. And there's a picture of him, it's kind of a blurry picture, it's blown up from a very, very small picture that I found in the archives, when he was born in 1865. But he was born here in Dryden, Michigan. The most important influence in his life was not his father, but his grandfather, Ethan Squier. And someone showed me today the deed that Ethan Squier received when he moved to this area, when the U.S. government was giving out land for people who had promised to farm it. He was one of the people who did that, he and his four brothers. He was a kind of a stern-looking guy, as you can see, and pretty hard-nosed and very, very successful farmer. His son, on the other hand, who was George's father, was an alcoholic, and he failed at everything he tried, whether it be farming or salesmanship or you name it, he drank it away. So Ethan, seeing that George did not have a mother, and seeing that he was a very bright young man, he took hold of his education and made sure that he was educated and that he would be a successful person. And his mathematics ability was quite striking, and he thought, well, this would make George a wonderful store clerk. And in fact, when George got the appointment to West Point, I'll get into that in a minute, he balked at it. Ethan balked at it. Why do you want to do that? Why don't you just go work for Mr. Lamb up in Imlay City? He's got a store, and when he retires, you'll have the store, and you'll be set for life. But George had bigger ideas. But it was a struggle for him. He hated to go against the wishes of his grandfather on the one hand. On the other hand, he wanted to make something of himself. he had a sister, Mary. And these two forlorn little kids on the left of George and his sister Mary when they were young. And the picture on the right is George and his sister Mary when he was a captain in the Army. And she was married to the town doctor, Dr. E.H. Parker, who stayed here his entire life, and I believe his house is still here in Dryden. That she's a very attractive young woman, and George is certainly a handsome young man. Here's Main Street, Dryden, in 1890. There's a farming community then, and I drove through that through the Main Street this morning, and I'm looking at some of the buildings. I believe that some of them are still there. It's of course a dirt road, horse-drawn carriages, and the like. But this is what George came from, and this was not a cosmopolitan area then at all. He was kind of a one of a kind in a place that didn't necessarily encourage this kind of intellectual striving. George wanted to become a man of letters, which in the 19th century was a shorthand for being an educated man. He wanted a college education, but he didn't have any money. There was one good way in those days to get a college education. It would be paid for by the government, and that was to go to one of the government's military academies. So he did apply to the United States Military Academy at West Point. He was very fortunate in that the U.S. representative who was making the appointments decided, rather than to bestow the appointment as a political favor, to have a competitive exam for the appointment. And George placed first, and he was set to attend West Point. Now, West Point, he was roughly 20 years old when he went to West Point. That was about 1885, give or take. 1883, give or take. Was actually intellectually, it was a post-Civil War West Point, but it had some really outstanding people teaching here. One of them was a fellow named Peter Mitchie. Peter Mitchie was a professor of what they call natural sciences, really physics at that time. And he had published extensively in a professional journal on the subject of wave motion. Wave motion was kind of the hot topic of the day in physics, because it has to do with not just waves in the ocean, but electromagnetic waves, which are radio, light, and the like. And the mathematics and the physics of these waves were very fascinating to the physicists of the day, and one of them was Peter Mitchie. And George studied under Peter Mitchie. So he knew about the science of wave motion himself. And, oh, by the way, Peter Mitchie was the father of a fellow named Dennis Mahan Mitchie, who was the first football coach at West Point. If you're familiar with the football stadium at West Point, is named Mitchie Stadium after Peter Mitchie's son, a little aside. George was very great. Even at West Point, he was number 7 in the 1887 class, very, very high. Now, at West Point, if you graduate high in the class, you have your choice of what part of the Army you go to. The better you do, the more the top guys went to the engineer, to the artillery, and the lower guys went to the infantry. George went to the artillery. And he was assigned to Fort McHenry in Baltimore. He picked Fort McHenry because, of course, that was an artillery assignment, coastal artillery assignment. But he picked it because it was the home of Johns Hopkins University, one of the premier universities of America at that time. And I'll tell you a little bit of how he took advantage of that. He was almost killed, actually, in 1890. He was in the vicinity of a heavy gun, 4.5-inch Wadman rifle, when the breech exploded when they were firing it. And the fellow standing next to him was killed, and he barely escaped with his life. So he was doing his job as an artillery officer, and we wouldn't have him, George, if he had stood a few feet closer to that gun. He also was farmed out to carry out summer training to the various National Guard organizations in the summertime, and he got high marks for that. He was considered to be an excellent officer. Knew his job, knew how to get men to do his bidding, and very, very outstanding fellow. But what he did do that was unusual, very unusual, was he went to Johns Hopkins as a graduate student. And Johns Hopkins was, as I say, one of the premier universities in America at the time. It was modeled after the great German universities. It was under the leadership of a fellow named Daniel Coit Gilman, who brought some of the best teachers in the country and in the world to teach at Hopkins. And George studied electrical engineering, a very, very new subject at that time, because the idea that one could actually predict what electricity would do was just coming into fashion, if you will, in the late 19th century. But George was also a practicing Army officer. So how was he going to do all this? How was he going to take courses and write a dissertation and do all of the things you have to do as a graduate student, and at the same time perform his duties as a military officer? So he did it. The way he did it was primarily to take duties on the weekends when his fellow officers would rather be off partying in Baltimore or attending cotillions and the like. George said, "No, I'll stay here, but you take my job when I'm in class." And he worked out pretty well. He was in a day when time management wasn't even talked about, he obviously managed his time well. He could do all of this. He wrote a dissertation, which you have to do if you're studying for the doctorate, and he did get a PhD in electrical engineering. Now, there's two things about this that are quite remarkable. There are only probably less than half a dozen people in the entire country in the 19th century with PhDs in electrical engineering. And he was one of them. And he was also, the other thing, he was the first Army officer to have a doctorate degree. There are a number of Army officers today have doctorate degrees, but this is pretty unusual. So he was among a very small group of engineers with PhDs, and he was one of a kind as an Army officer with a PhD in electrical engineering. He did a dissertation, as I say, with chemical effects due to magnetization, and he actually used that subsequently, as I'll mention. He was a guy that never stopped working and never stopped being intellectual, never stopped thinking about things and how to do things better. And he actually said, well, the Army needed a journal, a professional journal, where professional artillerists could propose new ideas and bounce them off their fellow officers and get criticized and constructively criticized for their work. And we need a journal to publish it. So he and several other people formed a journal, the Artillery Journal. He also was a person as most qualified and most energetic to propose the Army set up an electrical engineering laboratory for Fort Monroe, Virginia. And he did a lot of work on using his electrical engineering background in analyzing the behavior of artillery pieces. One of them was a note. He noticed that artillery would function better if the barrel was magnetized. And he wrote several papers on this. And I do not know if that is still true, but at the time it looked like a swell idea. And it was a swell idea for the razor blade industry, because when razor blades were first mass-produced by Gillette, they're magnetized. And the reason for that is to keep their edge better when they're magnetized. So that fact was used, and it came out of his work. Now, he's a serving Army officer. He has to go where he's told and do what he's told to do. He was also in the artillery, but he thought that the Signal Corps was probably a better fit, since he's an electrical engineer, better fit for his academic interests. So he transferred to the Signal Corps in 1899. And the chief signal officer, General Greeley, who was something of a scientist himself and a very interesting character in his own right, knew what Jeremy had in Squier. And what he did was he said, George, you're going to the Philippines and you're going to connect all the islands with a cables. The Philippines had just been taken over by the United States as a result of the Spanish-American War, and the only way to govern this archipelago was to have good communications, and the best way to do that is an undersea cable. So they would send a cable ship out there. The first one they sent out there, the Hooker, USS Hooker, after fighting Joe Hooker in the Civil War, it sank as it was leaving Manila Bay, much to the amusement of the Navy of the day, because it was an Army officer who was in charge of the ship. Did not cover the Signal Corps with glory, so that Greeley said, I'm going to set a good guy out there, and he sent Squier, and Squier spent a couple of years in the Philippines laying these cables, and 30 cables totaling 1,300 miles. Here's a picture of the group that was doing it, and reporting to the senior general in the Philippines, who was Arthur MacArthur, who was the father of General Douglas MacArthur, who was the governor general of the Philippines. But Squier's in the picture, he's the second from the right in the second row, the guy with the hat and the mustache. Kept that mustache for quite a while. Now, in those days, it was possible to do other things. Remember I said this, Squier was a guy who always liked to stay busy. And being in the Army wasn't enough for him, and doing his job as an Army officer wasn't enough for him. He had also a good scientific training, he got interested in a number of things. And in those days, you could. There wasn't any issue with an Army officer, say, selling ice cream, although it'd be probably looked upon disfavorably by his superiors. But if he was interested in sciences, generally speaking, he had a lot of background, and really background, in doing these things. So he worked with a guy named Albert Trefort when he was, again, in the Army. And he and Trefort developed a very, very sophisticated camera. And it's a little complicated, I won't go into the details of it, but the main thing about it was the shutter was not mechanical. What does this mean? It means that you can take you can take photographs of things moving very, very fast, because you don't have the inertia of the shutter getting in the way of taking the picture. So something that's happened in the less than a thousandth of a second, you can actually take a picture of. And what is this good for? As far as the Army is concerned, or as far as Squier's interest, you can figure out how fast a projectile is traveling when it leaves the barrel of a gun. Not only that, you can figure out how fast it's traveling in the barrel, when it leaves the barrel, and then further out. But you need a camera that can take a picture very, very fast. And so they came up with this particular device. The idea of a fast camera was developed many, many years later at MIT, that Harold Edgerton had developed, and probably seen the famous milk crop photograph that was in Life magazine years and years ago. But this was a big deal. And he and Creor developed this particular camera, and it had other uses other than measuring projectile speeds, and it could be used in telegraphy. So they actually formed a company to use it in high-speed telegraphy. Telegraphy was very important because that was how people communicated. There was no telephone system, a worldwide telephone system, but there was a worldwide cable system. The faster the cable worked, then the more information could pass on the cable, and the cheaper it got up to be, and they had a device to do that. Now, Krieger was an interesting man, brilliant guy, but he did his best work when he was working with Squier. And eventually he had, I won't say an unhappy man, but he happened to come up with a theory of the atom that was simultaneous with Niels Bohr's theory of the atom. And his Bohr's theory was right and his was wrong, which is okay, that's how science works. The trouble was he never admitted that it was wrong. And for 50 years, literally, for 50 years, he tried to prove that his theory was right in the face of all of the evidence that it was wrong. And he was still publishing in the 1950s. And you can see his books, they're available, believe it or not, on Amazon. But he was wrong. And so there's no point in reading them. And the scientists think he's a crackpot. But as a young man working with Squier, he did some very, very, very good work. If I were writing another biography, I'd love to write about Krieger, because how could somebody so smart go so wrong? But he did. And he was just stubborn. It's 50 years, it's a long time to be stubborn. Anyway, the next thing that Squier did was he went to Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, and with others founded the Signal School, which is to essentially provide the technical background for the Army's communications. One of his fellow staff members is a guy named Billy Mitchell, you've probably heard of. He was eventually court-martialed for doing something else with aviation, but he was well-known with Squier. And Squier got interested. As I say, he was always intellectually active, and he thought aviation was pretty interesting stuff. And he learned everything he possibly could about aviation, and thought a lot about not just aircraft, but also light-of-an-air machine, balloons, and dirigibles, and that sort of thing. But he developed a very intense interest in aviation, as well as his communication interests. The guy was super bright. And he followed through with both of these. In particular, he was the second passenger of the Wright brothers in their tests in 1908. The Army recognized that aviation might have a role in military warfare, and thought that they ought to buy a plane. And they commissioned that a specification be written. He wrote it, Squier wrote it, said that a specification for military aircraft to perform certain functions should be sent out to industry, and industry should respond. So it was a competition that the Wright brothers won. The aircraft, in fact, was built, and it went to trials of the finished aircraft at Fort Myer, Virginia. And the first passenger was a fellow named Frank Long, Lieutenant Frank Long. The second passenger was none other than George Owen Squier. And there's a plaque at Fort Myer in Virginia that points out that Squier was the Wright brother's second passenger. During these trials, another military officer was taken aloft, and this time the aircraft malfunctioned, and the man died. Lieutenant Selfridge died. And there's an Air Force base, I think it's in Michigan, called Selfridge Air Force Base, that's after Lieutenant Selfridge, who was the first person to die as a result of the aviation accident. It could have been Squier. Orville was at the controls and he lost control. Something went wrong and he lost control of the machine. He himself, Orville Wright, was severely injured, but he survived. But his passenger, Lieutenant Selfridge, did not. Now, this was a big setback for Army aviation, and it was kind of unfortunate, but the Army did press on with it. Here's the Wright brothers' plane. at Fort Myer. And here's a picture. The guy on the far left is General Squier, he's a major at the time. There's a guy in the straw hat with a stopwatch in his hand, Wilbur Wright, and they're just timing the flight. But he was right there front and center at the dawn, not only military aviation, but the dawn of aviation itself. He's a very prolific writer about aviation. He didn't lose his communication skills, though, because he did return to communications work when he wasn't flying with the Wright brothers. He was doing other things. And he felt, with others, that some of the ideas of radio technology should be applied to the telephone system. One of them being you could carry several conversations on a given wire, which you can't do. It's called multiplexing. And it was a brand new idea at the time. We do it now, we do it digitally, but the basic idea is you can put a lot of different conversations, a lot of different kinds of data on a single piece of wire. And you do it by imposing a single frequency and then modulating that single frequency. It's called carrier multiplexing. He invented it. He had the fundamental patent on carrier multiplexing. The whole United States telephone system is built around carrier multiplexing. And George Squier invented it. And he held the fundamental patent. When he got the patent, he did not keep it to himself, so to speak, or even try to sell it. He said this is for the general welfare of the United States and the communications industry in the United States, which led to some legal difficulties later on, but he essentially gave this idea to the people of the United States. So he's the father of the American telephone system. This is the same guy I'm talking about. I mean, he is a technical genius. He's also a very energetic person. I mean, he was never married. He had too many irons in the fire. But this is where it was done, by the way. This is the Bureau of Standards Office. He essentially had two places in D.C. One was the Bureau of Standards Office, the other was an Army base. And they got two conversations on a wire using the carrier multiplexer and showed that yes, indeed, the idea worked, and it was really in the patent. And the original scientific papers that established the capability were written by George Squier himself. There's at least a dozen papers in the archives that you can find that he talks about various aspects of this. So there's no question whatsoever that he was the chief mover and shaker of this. Now, for the next stage in his career, here's a man who's, of course, he's Army officer, but he's on first name terms with Alexander Graham Bell and the Wright brothers, and you name anybody who was anybody in American science around the turn of the 20th century. And he's also a senior Army officer. And the next stage in his career is in many ways even more remarkable. He goes to England. Why? Well, to this day, every embassy in the U.S. embassy in the world have what they call military attachés. And their role really is to carry out liaison with the country, with the military in the country that they're assigned to. And so it's generally given, this kind of assignment, it's generally given to someone with social credentials because he's expected to mix with the elite of the, I don't think it's so much today, but it was then. I wouldn't say you had to be a Vanderbilt or Rockefeller, but you had to be somebody whose name would be recognized. And he would not. He's a poor farm boy from Michigan. But General Leonard Wood, Chief of Staff in the Army, knew what a gem he had in Squier. And he said, he's the best qualified guy I get to send to Europe because we know there's going to be a war. We know, 1912, they know there's going to be a war. They don't know when it's going to happen, but they know it's going to happen. And we want somebody who understands modern war. He's the best guy I got. And then Walter Hines Page, who was the U.S. ambassador to England at the time, wanted somebody like Squier. He didn't want some social butterfly. He wanted a guy who was pretty hard-headed and knew science and could deal with his contemporaries in the British military. So he picked him. So Squier goes off to London, 1912. When the war starts, he's there. This is 1914, August 1914. He's there. He gets called by Lord Kitchener, who was the top guy. He was Ike Eisenhower of his day, or the General Marshal of his day. He's in charge of all of the British Army. He's a great war hero, and he has a responsibility for the conduct of the war, the British conduct of the war. He is the top person. He calls Squier and he said, I want you to go to France. And I want you to look at what the British Army is doing, and I want you to tell me what they need to fix, what's going wrong, how can we do things better. And of course, I know you'll tell the U.S. government, and that's what Kitchener wanted as well, because they were hoping that the Americans would come in. So, but I want you to go, and I don't want you to tell anybody you're gone. And we're going to give you a fake name and all of that, because all of the other attachés in England, their allies, the French attaché and the Russian attaché, they all wanted to go to the Western Front. They wanted to go to the war front. But Kitchener didn't want to send them. He wanted to send Squier. So he went in secret, and then he went three more times. And he reported back, and you can read his report in the archives of what he saw and what he thought needed. Needed doing, but he was just about as probably the single American officer who understood the First World War more than anybody else. He had been there, he'd seen what was going on, and he was very articulate, so he reported on that. While he was doing this, of course, he was still pursuing his commercial interests. And the British had something going on called the Marconi scandal, in which they were in the middle of the war, oddly enough, were prosecuting the Marconi company because the Marconi company, they thought, had illegally and through bribery obtained a commission to design British communication systems. So there's activity going on in the parliament to try to find out what was really happening and if there was corruption involved, and he was asked to testify. That's how important and how well known he was. He did, of course, try to interest the British people in his telegraphy inventions because he and Prehor still had the company. He wasn't successful in that. He also worked and was very knowledgeable first name terms with all of the leading British scientists in the telecommunications, Oliver Heaviside, and the people who were J.J. Thompson, the people who were the leaders of British science. So he carried on his scientific work as well as the work he was doing for Kitchener. So after this episode, he comes back to the United States. The reason he comes back is the U.S. Army is in charge of aviation. A lot of people forget that. But in the early days of aviation, there was no Air Force. In fact, there was no Air Force until 1947. The Army had control of the aviation assets. It was called the Army Air Corps in the Second World War, but it was still part of the Army. So the Army had the responsibility for aviation in the First World War, and they botched the job for some very good reasons. One of them is that when America came into the war, the Allies immediately asked America to provide them with a huge number of aircraft, 10 to 15,000 aircraft. And this is at a time when all aircraft were handmade, and two or three aircraft a month was probably about the maximum amount of production an aircraft company could do. So this is almost an impossible job, and the Army and General Squier, this is probably the single blackest mark on his reputation, but it's easy to fall to turn to the one industry that was familiar with mass production, automobiles. And the automobile industry said yes, they do the job. There was a lot of money involved. The single biggest appropriation ever made by the Congress up to that date was for military aviation. But building a car is not the same as building it, or building an aircraft is not the same as building a car. You know, a car runs on a gas, it parks on the side of the road, an aircraft runs on a gas, it falls. Something breaks on a car, you stop it. Something breaks on an aircraft, it crashes. So the requirements for aircraft are much more stringent than they are for cars. The automobile industry never got its arms around that. So we were never able to produce large numbers of aircraft during the First World War. We mostly flew aircraft provided by our allies, the French and the British. A lot of money was spent and not much to show for it. And Squier was the guy in charge, so he took a lot of the blame for it. But I think, you know, in retrospect, it's easy enough to see why he did what he did, but it didn't turn out particularly well for him. And he did get a black eye for it. But one thing he did do was standardize engine manufacture, and they built an engine called the Liberty engine, which is a modular engine way ahead of its time. You could build four cylinders, or eight cylinders, or 12 cylinders, or 16 cylinders, depending on the power plant, the size of the power plant that was needed. It was a brilliant concept, never came to fruition during the war, but it did afterwards, and the Liberty engines were very important in the early years of the 1920s aviation. But suffice it to say, the Squier did get this, he was the guy in charge, so he took the blame. And it was not a happy thing for him, but he did lose his job. He was still a chief signal officer until 1924. But you get an idea of the magnitude of the job. This is his office in Washington, D.C., 1918, when they're trying to get all these aircraft built. related to aircraft, and this is how I got into the Squier. Related to aircraft was the control of aircraft. Don't forget, in those days, when aircraft went up, there's no way to communicate to the pilot. No way for aircraft to communicate to each other. And you couldn't have wires connecting, obviously, the ground to the aircraft and the wires. So the only thing that showed any promise was radio, some form of radio. And the British and the French had a primitive means of communicating with aircraft, which used what they call spark transmitters. This is the old spark telegraph system. Well, I don't think anybody here has probably ever heard, but I have heard. It generates a spark, and that gets radiated, and you can pick it up. So it's a form of radio, but it doesn't have any selectivity. The French and the British were using that. The Squier recognized early on that telephony, in other words, to be able to talk to the pilot, was very, very important. And this is why the American succeeded, but the British and the French did not. Because he recognized that was important, and he recognized what needed to be done to give aircraft a means of communicating with the ground and each other by using human voice. This is a very, very big deal, very hard to do, extremely hard to do. But when he became in charge of Army aviation, of course he was already in charge of Army communication, he was the guy with the resources, with the power and the technical understanding to get the job done. And he did. He was a very, very unique individual. He was a kind of the right man in the right spot at the right time. And he was able to get this done when no belligerent in the First World War other than the Americans did. They built, under his leadership, the Army equipped its aircraft with a radio telephone system. And, of course, once you can communicate with an aircraft using a radio telephone, a radio, Joe, are you there? Over. Yes, I'm here. Over now. You could do it not only for aircraft, but you could do it for the ground. If the guy was in the tank, you could communicate with him. If the guy had a portable radio transmitter, you could communicate with a foot soldier without wires. And he saw all this. He had the vision to see that you could do this. And nobody else did. But not only that, he had the power to do it. And his technical understanding to do it. So what this says is, he said this in his report, his CSO 1919 report. Every year, the chief signal officer was required to tell the Congress, what have we done? And in the report, you find what his office has been doing. And it says, I'll read it because I think it's very, very important. And certainly the thing that makes you realize just how unique what he did was. The development of radio apparatus for telephone communication from plane to plane and from plane to ground was a challenging problem whose solution led to the development of the whole family of signal corps radio equipment, which it did. The technology of airborne communications is equally applicable to ground warfare. He developed tactical radios for the artillery, for the tank. To do this, you have to manufacture a lot of vacuum tubes, and they did. They manufactured well over a million vacuum tubes during the First World War. From nothing, almost from nothing. And it had to be reliable, it had to work in a high vibration environment. I mean, it had to be very, very well engineered. And because of him, it had to be rugged, it had to be lightweight, and it had to be standardized. So that you could take a tube out of one piece of equipment and stick it on another piece of equipment. The essence of a good engineering solution to a very difficult technical job. And he did it. With a lot of help, of course, but he had the vision to see that this could be done. And it was done. Here's a very famous picture. It's a little blurred. I've never been able to get that in pocket. It's the President of the United States in a hat in the middle, and he's talking to an aircraft. He's on the grounds of the White House. He's talking to an aircraft. Very, very convincing demonstration of what Squier did. Over a wireless telephone, and the aircraft was, this was, I can't think of anything, contemporary. These things are happening technologically so fast today that even the craziest thing you think about is going to happen. But anyway, like putting a computer in the phone. But this was just a technical rainbow or a beautiful technical vision. And here's the President of the U.S. talking to a pilot. It was a very big deal. Not only did Squier carry out the leadership of this effort, but people wanted to work for him. When you're as brilliant as Squier and as visionary as Squier, people wanted to work for him. And this guy, he's in the uniform of a major, his name is Edward Howard Armstrong. A lot of people never heard of him, but if you ask an electrical engineer who he is, they don't know him right away. He invented virtually everything you can think of that led to radio and television. He invented FM in the 1930s. He invented all of the parts of the radio, what I call the oscillator, the modulator, and the amplifier. And he did all of this before the First World War. He invented a circuit called a super heterodyne circuit, which is the basis of television and the basis for high quality radio. He is essentially the greatest electrical engineer of all time, at least in this country. And he worked for Squier. And Squier put him in charge of the Paris office of the Signal Corps. And that's where he did a lot of his work, and we go to the National Archives and read about his work building the super heterodyne radio. That's the kind of person that Squier attracted. And he wasn't the only one, but this is an example of the kind of person that Squier could get to work for. There is no better. Here's another picture of how eminent George Squier was, one of the most famous people in the country in the 1920s. Here he is standing with, you never heard of Francis Jenkins, he was a television pioneer, but the guy right next to him is David Sarnoff, whom you probably heard of, he's the first head of Radio Corporation of America. Here's General Squier, and the guy to his left is Herbert Hoover, before he became President of the United States. So he moved in pretty exalted circles. This is in 1924. He had just retired, I believe, as Secretary, as Chief Signal Officer, but he was moving in pretty rarefied circles at that point, with essentially leaders of American industry and politics. And I throw this back in because it's just so how far George Squier came from his boyhood here in Dryden to two forlorn little kids, both of them virtual orphans. The mother's dead, the father's a drug. And here he is with his sister Mary in the middle and her husband, Dr. Parker, going in to see the President of the United States. That's what he did. And here's a formal portrait of him. Upon his retirement, wearing some of his many, many decorations. And it's in the National Portrait Museum in D.C. And I'll conclude by showing you a picture of my book. I've signed a few copies of it today. It isn't my book, it's Paul Clark's book. It's one of Paul, as I mentioned, is 80 years old. And he really wanted to come today, but his health has not been good, and his wife prevailed upon him not to make the journey. But he's here in spirit, and through him, I got to know one of the greatest men, I believe, of the 20th century, and he grew up right here. Thank you.